Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us. This is Courtney Spearman, Design Specialist with the National Endowment for the Arts. I'd like to welcome you to the NEA's first webinar in our new Social Impact Design Now series, looking at the current state of the field in social impact design. Today, we'll be hearing from three designers who will discuss their work in social impact design and what they've learned from their experiences as sole practitioners, directors for nonprofit organizations, and leaders in local government initiatives, respectively. I'd like to thank Katie Crepeau, editor for Impact Design Hub, for working with us to organize this conversation, and I'll turn the microphone over to her very soon. But before we hear from Katie and our distinguished presenters, a few housekeeping notes. You are all muted and will only be able to hear us. We will give a brief series of PowerPoint presentations followed by a curated discussion and then Q&A for the last 15 minutes or so. You can submit questions and comments at any time using the Q&A box below the PowerPoint on your screen. We will do our best to address as many questions as possible during the time that we have. Please do not use the raise hand button. And then this webinar will be posted in the webinar section of the NEA website, that's arts.gov, in a few days so you can refer to it in the future. You can also register for our upcoming webinar series, webinars in this series in May and June on that same page. And please join our conversation on Twitter. That's hashtag NEA Design. I'll pass it over to Katie now.
Thanks so much for the introduction, Courtney, and especially for inviting me to host this panel on practicing social impact design. I'm thrilled that we have the chance to dive into the inner workings of design firms today. This is a topic that I've been pursuing for over 8 years now, and I know there's a ton of other people out there who are equally interested in learning how do people do it. So lucky for us, today we're joined by three exceptional practitioners who are going to share with us how they got started, how they operate, and what opportunities they're most excited about for the future. Our first presenter, change the slide, will be the enthusiastic and very passionate Catherine Darnstadt, who's the founder and principal of Leighton Design. The firm was founded in 2010 and is now a registered benefit corporation, and I believe it's the first architecture firm to be registered as this in Illinois. The three-person team works at the intersection of design and community development, primarily in Chicago and across the U.S. Second up will be Matthew Manos of Very Nice, who is perhaps the most experienced social impact designer out of the five of us here today. He began his career at age 16, so I won't give away how old he is today. That's up to you to guess. But Matthew is a social entrepreneur, strategist, and writer, exploring experimental economies and conditional systems for creative inquiry. Very Nice was founded in 2008 to provide design, strategy, and foresight services, half of which are given away for free to nonprofits. And our last presenter, but definitely not least, will be the creative guru, Paul Chazin, who just celebrated his 4-year anniversary as an urban designer with the San Francisco Planning Department. Before he moved into his current position, co-managing the Living Innovation Zone program, Paul managed San Francisco's popular Parklet program, which I'm sure many audience members are familiar with. But before we get started on the presentations, I'd like to quickly introduce the Impact Design Hub, where you can find out more and read more about what we'll be hearing about today. So the site was founded by John Kerry in 2011 as publicinterestdesign.org. Last fall, we relaunched it to position it as the online resource for architects, designers, and people committed to designing a better world. We're really aiming to advance the social impact design field by providing access to information and building a greater discourse through weekly feature articles on key issues, a new job board with opportunities, a database that launched last month to map people and organizations working around the world, and also just continue the popular daily news blog that we've been running for 4 years now. So if you're interested in reading more, you can visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter. We also have a weekly newsletter that sends the top posts straight to your inbox. All right, now let's get started with the presentations. Catherine will start us off by sharing what an architectural social enterprise looks like. So turning it over to you, Catherine.
Yeah, thank you so much, and hello, everyone. Thank you for having me. I'm incredibly excited about all these three upcoming social impact webinars as I feel I intersect and consider on a daily basis how my firm reacts to these issues around gender equity and emerging practitioners in this field. So to give you a hilarious backstory, I founded Latent Design back in 2010 as my plan B option to float myself through the recession as a newly licensed and, of course, newly laid off architect. So with $10,000 and a laptop, the firm was broke and a failure by the end of the first business day, which was okay because I was naive, I was bold, and I had a post-it note business plan, and we just kind of continued on to now celebrating the start of 5 years in business. And I could definitely say it's very easy to start a firm. The fifth year is incredibly difficult. If I knew how hard the fifth year would be, I would have never done year one. Much of the firm's early work included pro bono and volunteer design services with local and national community organizations, and this work helped form our social impact mission and focus on civic practice, as well as early lessons on the limitations of design and the difficulty in trying to authentically engage, listen, and co-design while scaling a business. And differentiating the firm among the density of architects and the history of architecture in Chicago is still a work in progress. As over 90% of our projects are in Chicago, we undertook a process last year to define a Chicago design system and show direct correlations and scales of design impact between a bench, a business, a building, and ultimately up to the block, neighborhood, and regional scale. We did this, and we started to do this by reading as many city plans that were released in the previous 4 years from every department within the city and aggregate all that information. It was very exciting, it was exhausting, it was sometimes boring, but what we did is we started to simplify the information for our purposes into 7 design priorities that we analyze our projects around. And so that's engagement, education, economics, culture, policy, health, and transit. We provide all of our clients and all of our projects now with information on how their project could fit into these priority areas with specific metrics and examples that directly correlate to the particular city plan that we're pulling from. It's this understanding of the latent city system that we see is our value proposition and makes us unique from other firms that are operating in the field of architecture, at least in Chicago. And it's also these lessons from our early activist clients and projects that helped us understand that tactical leverage is a critical part of the design process to shape an outcome. Our services now are categorized into 3 strategies areas: define the context, design the content, and deploy a solution. The design services in the middle are traditional architecture. That's where we started. But we have define at the front end, encompassing more soft strategy and engagement services, and deploy at the back end, encompassing some of the more physical items. We use a very tactical word, deploy, because I have a very strong bias for action, and as well as a strong and high comfort level with risk, so we could do that. And we have formalized this in the firm to now include general contracting services as well as urban development. An example of a type of project, which we might talk about later, is how a grassroots design initiative I developed back in 2010 as one of our first pro bono projects has scaled to a stage where we are leading a multi-year partnership to launch Chicago's citywide creative placemaking initiative and develop qualitative design impact metrics for the program. So everyone on the call, please wish us luck on that. And the firm is hitting 5 years old, and today our firm has expanded to 3 employees and has had an increase in the quantity and scale of projects, but still, luckily, still the same diversity of sectors that we work in, from public health, affordable housing, and even our first bar, because much of this work makes me want to drink, that's for sure. We work with equal amounts of public, community, and private clients now, so it's probably a little bit of a third of each, whereas at the beginning when we launched in 2010, it was much heavier on the public and community clients, and now it's shifting, it's evening out. Throughout this work, we have utilized a variety of revenue mechanisms. So depending on the project, our traditional fee-for-design service work could be funded through local and national grants, as well as private funding. We do also co-develop grants with clients, larger grants that fit within our larger design system and urbanism point of view, which means we do offer minimal design services to complete that application. We pursue limited pro bono work now only as part of a larger design team with parallel design industries. So right now we're working on a pro bono project with graphic designers, organizational strategists, photographers, videographers to work around a larger issue. We do not pursue pro bono architectural services solo because the projects don't scale in isolation and we don't think it's the most effective use of how design can show impact. And we do all of this to build agency and access through design with our clients and to use design to shift the power structures in this city that I am a citizen in and a designer of. Because I can't decouple those two, it's an incredibly personal practice and a personal process that we implement on our projects on a daily basis, and it's because of the way that we look in the city and acknowledge that we live in the city as well and have a specific expertise around design that we could work with the specific expertise of our community partners and clients to scale all of the work and show the impact around design. And so with that, we've been very fortunate, and I thank you for hearing this short introduction.
Great. Thanks so much, Catherine. Can't wait to hear more during the discussion period. So next up is Matthew, who will present Very Nice's very intriguing Give Half model. Matthew, you're up.
Awesome. Thanks so much. Again, thanks for having me here. A really incredible group of people and also just a really great initiative of the NEA in general. So really happy to be a part of this. So yeah, let's get right into it. I'm going to talk to you guys a little bit about our mission and sort of values as a company, as well as a little bit of a look inside of our business model. Every year in the United States alone, nonprofits are actually spending close to $8 billion on people like me. This is on design and marketing type of services. And this is really frustrating to me because I like to imagine what the world could look like if the same types of quality services were made available in a way that was more affordable to little or no cost to these organizations. From my perspective, this could result in a world where some of the most persistent problems, things like hunger, housing, water access, et cetera, can actually be solved not by doing a whole lot of extra work, but instead by reallocating resources that already exist. And this is where pro bono comes in my field. It's short for pro bono publico, which literally means for the good of the public. And I got my start as a pro bono practitioner when I was 16 years old, actually through a connection I made while at a skate park. I was skateboarding competitively at the time. And I met a man in a wheelchair who was ripping around the park, literally did a flip. Obviously, this isn't something that you see every day. So I was intrigued to roll a bit closer to him, introduce myself, and I ended up learning that he was the founder of a nonprofit that at the time was teaching children in wheelchairs how to participate in extreme sports. About a week prior, I had gotten my first copy of Photoshop and was starting to teach myself things here and there, and inspired by his mission, I knew I wanted to help, and I donated some of my time to design some stickers to promote the organization. A few years later, after that day, I started Very Nice while in college at UCLA, and we've now grown to become a global design strategy and foresight consultancy that gives half of its work away for free to nonprofit organizations. In terms of our model in general, this give half model, really how it can be broken down is to this method that I like to call the double half methodology. This is based on a little bit of funny math and also terrifying realization that I had, which is that if you want to give half of your work away for free and do just as well as the other guy, meaning any other studio in our space, we actually have to do twice the amount of work that they do. When you add that up, it actually results in this realization that that will allow you to do the same amount of paid work and therefore, in theory, will allow you to be sustainable and thrive and all of that. What I ended up finding was that we obviously needed a creative way to increase our bandwidth. And as a result, we now leverage a very unique staffing model where we leverage a giant network of volunteers and contractors to partner with us on a per-project basis in order to execute our work. The way that our services actually look like is broken into three categories. This is design, strategy, and foresight. Our clientele, as I mentioned, half are nonprofit organizations, but on the other side, we have a pretty diverse group, about 25% making up startups and small businesses, an additional 20% in the for-profit social enterprise space, and then 5% or maybe a little bit less in the Fortune 500 range. Our services are bucketed in these three ways, and they cover all kinds of things, including trends analysis, competitive analysis, and brand positioning, web design, photography, video. We consider ourselves transdisciplinary and really value the idea of design as being a practice that requires strategy first, and then that solutions can actually derive from this unique thinking and can be almost agnostic in terms of what medium we use. In terms of our business growth and our sort of referral base, like many other design firms, we do work almost entirely off of references from previous clients or from people within our network in general. Something that is unique about us, though, is that we've found that our pro bono work actually does serve as an integral tool for growing our business as well. It allows us to experiment in new industries and new skills that we might want to develop to offer clientele. But it also gives us unique access to many impactful corporate CEOs that are on the board of the organizations that we work with. So we found it to be a great networking tool as well. To date, we've been around for about 7 years, and we've been able to donate the equivalent of over $2.5 million worth of services to hundreds of organizations spanning 45 countries. So we're really excited about the next 5 years and what that will mean for our growth, but also for the growth of our impact and the continued growth of this pro bono movement in the design space. So with that, I want to say thanks. Look forward to questions later.
Great. Thanks so much. That was really fascinating, Matthew. And now Paul is going to share more about innovating within government with the Living Innovation Zone program.
Hi, thanks so much, Courtney and Katie, for having me. So like you guys heard, my name is Paul. I work at the planning department in San Francisco. I'm an urban designer. My background's in both planning and landscape architecture. And I used to manage the Parklet program. I'm not going to be talking about that today, but if people have questions about that, we can talk about that. I'm happy to talk about that in the Q&A afterwards. So the Living Innovation Zone program is kind of this adaptable permitting tool that we've developed to permit kind of dynamic and still creative installations on Market Street in the city. The program was started as kind of a joint effort between the planning department and the mayor's office of civic innovation, or MOCI. And we were both kind of working on these different projects that we fused together. They were looking at ways to bring, they're kind of a group within the mayor's office that's tasked with making the city more nimble and adaptable and kind of like just quick and creative. And we were looking, and they were looking at ways to bring in sort of some of the energy that's happening right now, especially in the private sector in San Francisco, to government. And the planning department was looking at redesigning Market Street, and Market Street's like our main streets, our civic central spine, and how we can make the street more kind of active and dynamic and stuff. On top of that, we the plan department had done a lot of work experimenting with things like parklets and similar temporary installations, and we were looking at ways to kind of continue that experimentation. And so we mushed these together sort of to champion the public good to create these creative prop things on Market Street. So the talking point is kind of that we are the innovation capital of the world. We're the ground, San Francisco's ground zero for this kind of tidal wave of change that's reshaping everything we do. And yet walking down the city streets, there are no monuments to it. There's no, you wouldn't know that you're the sort of center of this place at this really big moment that we're going through. The program goals sort of are centered around showcasing the city's creativity, both, you know, within and without and outside the bureaucracy. How bureaucracies tend to be conservative, we want to figure out how we can make the city more nimble and kind of open to new ideas. Sort of good ideas deserve a platform. And then given Market Street itself, it's kind of a very formal corridor, and how can we make it more responsive and adaptable to the different neighborhoods that it goes through, and allow those neighborhoods to sort of have an active role in programming the space. Fundamentally, the main goal is about activating public space and bringing people together. So the program set up, so we're going to be doing 10 sites on Market Street. The locations will vary. They are they're installed for up to 2 years, so the installation will vary, but it's a maximum of 2 years for each site, and then hopefully something else will replace it. Living innovation zones is fast. We try to be really nimble and adaptable in our permitting strategy and how we, you know, and so when we have written the rule book about how the program works, we try to be really loosely defining things as minimally as possible to allow designers like yourselves like as much creative freedom to kind of push us, but just give us enough structure that designers have something to work off of, that we can sort of have some design authority if we need to. And then the other piece, the bottom half of the slide, is kind of talking about, we try to think of this program as really not art or design or tech or innovation, but really sort of as operating in this gray space between these things where they kind of fuse together and it's not sort of clear on what the boundaries are. And we sort of try to set up these creative collaborations between different organizations to allow that to happen. And so it's the three main kind of participants. There's the city, the community, and then what we call the creative lead or the designer. And the designers, the creative lead is like an organization that might have an interesting story to tell, but they don't know how to build something, so they'll hire architects or tech partners or other sub-consultants to work with them. The community is represented through these community benefit districts. On Market Street, they're like nonprofits that help kind of do street cleaning and activities on the street in their neighborhoods, and also the printing property owners. So this is kind of our process diagram. I'm not going to go into the details. There's a whole spaghetti of city departments that are involved. Essentially, the main thing is that we try to pre-vet sites before we have issue a call for projects. The city will work with local property owners and so forth to make sure that we have a site that we can build something. We'll then issue a call for projects through an RFP process, choose people, all the different entities kind of sign an MOU expressing their intent to work together, and then it moves through a pretty typical design process where somehow they create permit drawings, construction drawings, we review them, and then they go and build them. And then we're about to publish, similar to the parklet manual, if any of you have seen that, it's like a LIS manual. What's the difference with these is that we've tried to be, like I said, really loose in the way that we define how this document works, and so it's a much lighter document, but it kind of gives an overview for the program. And then in terms of how the projects themselves are funded, they're different. This is the one that we've built so far. This was built by the Exploratorium. It got a grant from, I believe, the Knight Foundation, and the Yerba Buena Community Benefit District also chipped in some money for it. This is another one that was funded by a foundation. This one is going to come up in the fall. It's an illuminated bench that is designed to sort of showcase the mural that you can see on the right, and see if it was sitting on the bench and admire the mural. It was foundation funded. And this one is another one that's coming up this summer. This is going to be a mobile art studio that moves up and down Market Street. It'll be programmed with different performance artists. The Planning Department and the Arts Commission have funded it for one iteration on Market Street, and then the artist is using that to seed more funding. To date, just in terms of funding, we don't have an active funding stream yet. The goal is once we have a few projects up, we can kind of put in budget requests and go and speak to funders and try to set up those partnerships, and we're kind of in the beginning stages of those conversations now. So I believe that is the end of my presentation. Thanks. Hello?
Katie, are you there? I think you might be on mute.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, there you go. Did you?
Okay. I think it was delayed or something.
Okay, good. I think you're good now. Thanks.
Okay. Thanks so much, Paul, for that. To kick off the discussion portion, I'd like each of our practitioners to rewind back to the time when you were starting out in social impact design, either as a practitioner or, you know, getting started in government. And I think I'll pick on Matthew first, since you've been at this the longest. And I'd like you just, if you could tell us how you overcame starting very nice without other precedents or mentors to help really guide the creation of the business.
Yeah, absolutely. As I mentioned, this company did have origins in basically a career I started in high school. And what became really hard about that was being another young guy that wants to, young college student that wants to change the world is kind of a cliche story, to say the least. So I think as a result, you know, of I guess like the naive appearance I gave off, it actually became very hard to find mentors and people that were sort of on board with the idea of this model. A lot of my professors at the time and a lot of my peers even really kind of flat out said that very nice was a dumb idea. So it was quite a hard thing to overcome, but I'm really grateful that I somehow decided not to listen to a lot of that negative feedback. I've found that over the years, pro bono in general has grown as a movement, but also just this idea of social enterprise, thanks to a lot of more kind of mainstream product type of companies that have come to the surface, this really has become a greater conversation in general.
Yeah, and Catherine, you talked about having this be a plan B, whereas, you know, Matthew started out with it as a focus. And were there any, like, inspirations or precedents that you looked at when you were starting out late in design?
Absolutely. There, you know, it was a plan B for me within the field of architecture itself, but the type of work that I'm doing now within the firm and that we're doing, it started because I had an interest in affordable housing. And so I worked for an affordable housing firm in Chicago and a developer, and learning the different kind of perspectives and policy factors around affordable housing. And it was on that particular track of my kind of informal architectural education post-graduation that I was laid off. And so within that, I still wanted to stay within this work and have that mission of using design for equity. I just didn't know how to go about it because there weren't as many firms as mentors, and I didn't know about this movement starting out. So when I first started doing this work in Chicago, I turned to other parallel design professions that worked within or claimed to work within the social impact realm. So that was graphic designers. One of my mentors to this day is Don Hancock at Firebelly Design. And, you know, learned how they were structuring their firm and their work and how they were grappling with personal issues of clients versus impact within the firm. And from that network, I started to look at everyone but architects doing this work. And I learned so much of how to frame the business strategy from that and then brought it back to the field of architecture and started conversations with other new practitioners, young practitioners, or even second career practitioners who wanted to, were already focusing on community work, but maybe we were all starting to coalesce around these terms of public interest design and social impact. So it was very fortuitous that, you know, a global conversation and a local conversation merged at the time that I was having the firm. So that was a very, very lucky experience for me.
Yeah, and I think, Paul, when I spoke with you, you talked a little bit about how maybe the parklet program influenced some of the Living Innovation Zone and the like fast and quick, how that has maybe come about into influencing Liz.
Yeah, so like when with the parklet program, you know, the parklets were, when they were started, just so for people that aren't familiar, if you Google parklets, Google images, parklets are like little mini, where the city allows people to convert an on-street parking space into a little mini park, like a little deck that extends the sidewalk. And so the city has had this program for up and running for about 5 years now. And we were the first city to do it, so there wasn't really a template for it. You know, what we found is when we were sitting around doing that, and this is before I got to the department, but I kind of inherited the program when the former project manager took another job and it was given to me. But when the city was sitting around doing it, there was a lot of fear about whether it would work, you know, whether these should be public spaces or private spaces, like extensions of a restaurant that was sort of doing it. And what we found is that when we opened up the thing, what we sort of did is we created this platform that allowed members of the public and lay people, specifically people who aren't developers, who aren't kind of formally trained architects, to have a role in placemaking. And the city kind of framed the program in this kind of rhetoric of like this very highly lofty civic goals. You know, you're sort of participating in public space, you're helping, you're part of this movement, and these are publicly accessible spaces, and everyone, and that seemed to really resonate with people. And so with Liz, and also another one project people might check out is the Market Street Prototyping Festival, which launches tomorrow. It's this huge project. The city has been inviting, trying to find ways to invite other people to participate in space and democratize the process of placemaking, which has been really successful. We found that a lot of people are really curious and enthusiastic about participating in those kinds of exercises. This is like a natural extension of that. Sorry.
Yeah, yeah. And I think, Catherine, you also spoke about how when you were starting, a lot of the early projects were really small and quick. And how did you, I guess, expand your and diversify your portfolio?
Yeah, that's great. And I think it's a good segue from Paul because, as you know, Chicago's status as a second city, we really want to emulate things that we see in San Francisco and New York, and one of those was the placemaking in public space initiatives. And so we started a public space initiative called Activate Chicago back in 2010, which focused on small-scale temporary placemaking interventions on vacant lots or vacant public property, you know, excess concrete, and we had to do it for $1,000 budget. And that has now scaled over the past 4 years to where we're kicking off the citywide creative placemaking initiative. So what we started as a grassroots organization and a grassroots project ultimately put us in a position of power to start to help the city and work directly with the city to break down some of the policy and design and community barriers that stop this work from happening organically, because there were not only issues around legalities, but then there are issues around funding, and we had to have a more systemic conversation. If we all want to achieve the same goals of positive public space, there are critical issues that an individual or community group can't address on their own, so we had to turn to the city to formalize an informal process to allow it to continue to grow. And the photo up now is from one of our Woodlawn. It's on the south side by University of Chicago. This was one of the 2013 installation on about I think it's around 30,000 square foot public plaza that was just all concrete at the intersection of a gang territory, two different gang territories, next to a recently closed Chicago public school. So it was a very volatile area. And we just worked with the community to decide to gamify the plaza just using paint and creative activity, healthy activity zones. And one of them, the one you're seeing, is the competitive hopscotch, because why play hopscotch alone when you could do it with friends?
Nice. Very fun. So I'm just going to switch a little bit to Matthew, because you started out focusing on the model, not necessarily the work, because that was one thing you said was really interesting to you. So how did that I guess what was the driver behind that, and how did you kind of shift the conversation?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think a big part of the driver of creating a model was that when Very Nice was started, I was exclusively doing pro bono work and wasn't taking on any paid work for, I think, actually the first full year. And then obviously reality kicks in and you realize that you have to make a living when you're out of school. So then all of a sudden I became fascinated by this idea of being able to still give back as much as possible while still staying afloat. And that's where this kind of passion for models came from. But then that later evolved in several ways, one of which relates to the image that's up on the PowerPoint right now. I realized that with this growing movement of design entrepreneurs in general, there's a lot of emphasis on products and services and what those look like. And then the model seems to be kind of an afterthought. And I'm really fascinated by this idea that if we could actually go back in time to how businesses really originally were cultivated, which was model first, and kind of shifting that thinking, we could have a lot more sustainable businesses in the impact space. And so we launched this project called Models of Impact that's available at modelsofimpact.co. And it's an attempt to essentially document every business model in social enterprise to serve as a resource for people who are looking to launch a business in this space or are looking to really kind of align themselves with an existing model out there or even invent a new one. We're in the middle of prototyping a game version of that, which is all kinds of fun. But then also on that note, kind of another direction, with the book that I wrote, How to Give Half of Your Work Away for Free, that really came about because I started to realize every public talk that I ever gave about Very Nice, I never was talking about the work we were doing. I was just talking about the model that actually happened again today. And I guess that realization drew me to this idea that perhaps as a designer, my role is to have this kind of conversation around models and sustainability and really spreading that to others. So that's really what my main interest and my main purpose within the company is today.
That's great. And speaking of funding models, Paul, you mentioned that you guys have been looking at different ways to actually fund the different Liz installations. What have been some of the challenges with that, or what are you guys planning to do in the future to provide more access or to, I guess, create more Liz's?
Yeah, no, that's a good question. I mean, one of the things that's, I think, been frustrating or challenging, I should say, with parklets, and we're seeing parklets are moving beyond that now, and Liz is at a much younger stage in its kind of program life. We have access to, you know, we sort of have the authority to say, to allow people to do stuff, but we don't always have funding, you know, like to just get people to do projects. With parklets, it's taken a while for parklets to become established, and now the supervisors, which is like our super city council, can give money in the budget and put in our budget to fund parklets in high needs areas, or we can prioritize parklets that are like with museums or youth design build projects or whatever it is that have kind of a more of a social sort of impact. With funding for Liz, what we're doing is we're kind of publishing this document, and we've spent quite a while like writing it to try and get it right. We've had some initial conversations with funders. There's a lot of interest, I think, in the funding community about this kind of like gray zone between art and design and public space. And so the idea is that we'll then take our Liz model to both grant funders and then also property owners on Market Street. There's a lot of redevelopment happening right there, and some of them might be interested in helping sponsor stuff in front of their buildings. The long-term goal, hopefully, is that we'll also be able to get the city to sponsor funding. And like one of the other ways that we've done it with city funding is that where the city, oftentimes we don't have a lot of money and we have to be careful about how we give it out. So we'll give like some seed funding to a project, and having the city on board, even for like kind of a token amount, can really help their conversations with funders and help them kind of leverage our money to get more money. So those are some of the different ways we're trying to do that. I mean, I think one thing about these, one of the appeal to these things is, like, even though they're sort of subversive, going back just a second to, like, the hopscotch photo, like, these projects are sort of subversive in that they're kind of, like, not sanctioned, which makes them subversive, but there's something that's, like, so not cynical and optimistic about them. It seems, I think, like, people really feel positive about them and are able to sort of get on board. So funders, bureaucrats, the public, there's something like really magical about that where that happens, and I think that that's why they're fundable in the long run for people.
Yeah, and I think you also have mentioned that the importance of really having, you know, other people within government to work with to create these and make these new initiatives happen. Can you maybe talk a little bit about Moki and how they've been instrumental in that? In making Liz happen, as well as the
We actually have a really nice. It's interesting. I've worked on collaborative projects where there's, especially in government, you get oftentimes people from different departments get really turfy and territorial about jurisdiction and stuff. And with Moki, it's been a really healthy collaboration. It's really great being able to work with the mayor's office. The weight of that office helps us at times if we need to push stuff through the city bureaucracy. We can kind of send an email, or, you know, people behave differently when the mayor is involved, and so that's really helpful. It also, I think, is helpful, you know, when we're meeting with members of the public, they, you know, having the mayor's office at the table makes them feel, for lack of a better term, like more listened to and important, and that makes people want to sort of play with us. So when we're trying to do the outreach to get permission to put something in front of someone's building, that's been really great. And they just have a lot of, you know, this office in particular, both my office and the Moki office are sort of change agent groups within government, where both the way we're structured is relatively nimble. It allows us to sort of work in a mode that allows for more flexibility and creativity than some other branches of government. And so it's just been a really healthy collaboration. They're also really helpful with the outreach when we have, like, the ribbon cuttings and stuff like that.
Yeah, and that kind of probably resonates, I bet, with Catherine and Matthew about being nimble and trying different things and being really flexible as you build your business. I guess what were some of the things that helped you succeed and kind of get to where you are today, Catherine?
As I mentioned in the introduction, there's two key pieces that I think have been incredibly influential on getting me to the position where I am today. First, I'm a firm believer in the proposed National Design Services Act, which helps alleviate architectural student debt in exchange for community design service work. And I think one of the only reasons that I could start a firm or take that risk to start a firm is because I had no debt from school at all. So it wasn't a decision where I felt that I was already in a hole. I've spent the last 5 years, you know, making the hole for myself to fall into, but I didn't start that way, and I wouldn't have ever taken that risk if I knew I had the additional liability beyond family and house to also be paying off my student debt. It gave me a lot of liberation and freedom. The other thing is that aversion to risk and that ability to see what a design risk is and what a citizen risk is. And sometimes they merge together because what I want, you know, Paul is talking about in San Francisco, this placemaking initiative, and at the city department, they are fortunate at planning and the Department of Transportation there to have the capacity to do that. But here in Chicago, we do not. I mean, we are a very broke city that's going to continue to rely on public-private partnerships to get basic services completed in our city. And if we want something that becomes more cultural or more design-oriented, we essentially have to find a way to fund that ourselves, whether that's through sponsorship, partnership, or other revenue models, or everyone becoming really rich, or design becoming a value. We're working at trying to change that in multiple ways, but then we also saw an opportunity of what would it look like if a small company like ours was a public-private partner with a city around a small project
of space and place and placemaking and arts in the city of Chicago, and that's an initiative that we took on. So if it wasn't, if I had any debt and I was averse to risk, I would have never taken that on, and that has started to shift where the firm goes. And we see it as how can we use the firm and the flexibility within the firm to respond to some of the gaps within the design infrastructure that if we were only looking at architecture alone, we'd still be waiting for someone to give us a commission around this. And it wouldn't happen because there's no infrastructure in place to actually do that because no one's making the system. So we decided to make that system.
Yeah, and I imagine, Matthew, that resonates a lot with you, moving beyond just the design work, but also doing strategy and the foresight work. Can you talk a little bit about how that those services have evolved to meet client needs?
Absolutely. It's what's been kind of interesting about the growth of Very Nice, and I mentioned a little bit earlier that pro bono has allowed us to enter new disciplines that we perhaps previously weren't qualified to do through kind of an openness to experimentation and really trying new things in general. What we started to find was that while we had launched really specifically focused on traditional graphic design, things like branding and web design, we started to really find that there was this need in the market, especially a need of our clients to think beyond that and almost to become a place where people can come and not necessarily know what they need, but instead be a place where people can come and be open to all the possibilities of what they might need. And really that brought us to implementing strategy into every project that we do and developing a lot of our own sort of proprietary workshops that we run our clients through. Foresight is a very new addition. We were really fortunate to be approached by a great futurist named Jake Dunnigan in his interest of launching a Foresight division for Very Nice. And really where we see that coming, that division's roughly 6 months old, we see that growing into another service like strategy that takes place across all of the work that we do, where we can not only help our clients think about, okay, you know, what are the problems you're facing right now, but what are the problems you might face in 10, 20 years? It's a really exciting new path that we're sort of going down.
Yeah, it's really exciting. Just a note that we can open up questions for the Q&A period now, but we'll just keep going until we start getting them in. So if you're listening in or on Twitter, please put them in there and we'll be tracking them and hopefully answering quite a few of them. So I guess kind of looking towards the future, especially since we're on the topic of foresight, what are some of the areas, Catherine, that you're looking to kind of expand into or grow your practice?
So this year we took on quite a big change for us where we received our general contractor's license and are pursuing projects around becoming a full design build firm, and we want to do that around a specific scale of small projects, which we see are around, you know, a $200,000 development budget or less. So that could be anything from the placemaking initiatives that we're working on to, you know, a small storefront renovation, a cafe, things like that. Those are the smaller projects where we have a great amount of our clients work in kind of that area, and we could leverage quite a bit with our design services. So we decided to take on and try and create the whole entire project from concept to construction. So we're going to be feeling that out and tweaking that the whole entire year as we work on projects and see how that process actually works on paper versus in reality. So that's one of the areas that we want to be very strategic and we're going to have and grow into. So that was the major risk that we took on this year.
Well, it'll be fun to see how you guys do. So we have a few questions coming in right now. Some of them, I guess, Paul, one of them for you, and Catherine, you might also be able, and Matthew, too. Do you see, this is from Kat, and she asks, do you see pop-ups as temporary interventions?
I can take a crack at that. So we have traditionally used the word temporary in quotation marks. We use the word strategically in planning. When it makes sense to call them temporary, we'll call them temporary. Sometimes, like with parklets, for example, they're temporary in that the architecture of them is non-invasive. They sort of float on top of the street. If something isn't working, we can take it away. The world won't come to an end. We're not in the hole like $200,000 to tear up the road and fix it. With Liz, they're temporary in that we keep them up for 2 years, a maximum of 2 years. That initially sort of grew out of a compromise we made with our Arts Commission, where we were having a jurisdictional fight, and we sort of said, okay, we'll make them 2 years, and we'll also make you project partners, and then we can sort of all get along. But I think the ephemeralness of the projects, these installations, actually kind of makes them more special. When people know they're going to go away, then there's kind of a mourning process, and it helps us put a new one in. The first, Liz, that was, you saw with the whisper dishes and the singing bench, there's been a couple photos of it. That one's two-year window is coming up, and what we're talking about doing with that is we've gotten an extension for it, and then we're going to patch it up a little bit because it's kind of starting to fall apart. It's not designed to be a permanent installation. And then we're going to move it to another site on Market Street and see and put, and so that way we can use the initial architecture structure to sort of help seed a new Liz site. And we're kind of working on that right now. So temporary can be for really temporary, but the goal is to make them kind of the sites where these things go are permanent sites, where there'll be a constant gallery of rotating exhibitions.
And I completely agree with Paul. We see temporary interventions or pop-ups, quote unquote, as part of long-term redevelopment efforts, and it's not necessarily gentrification from a negative point of view. We see it as a community co-development style project. What we've worked in that temporary intervention realm for 4 years, and we saw that we hit a barrier at a certain point in time where our informal activations, which are borderline illegal in many cases, people want to replicate, but then they hit up against the policy barriers. So we spent the last year working with the city and the mayor's office and multiple different departments in the city to break down what those barriers are, where we had to write two new pieces of ordinance. We had to get new grant funding. We had to make the temporary, which was growing in popularity, and people wanted the end result of reusing vacant storefronts or reimagining public space, to make that actually possible in a very legal sense and a funding sense. Or else it's all sweat equity, and there is it's sweat equity that might not be able to be sustained unless there's a clear partnership between the public of the community and the private of the businesses, as well with the public of the city. So we see this all as a public-private-public partnership, not just the two P's, it's all three.
Yeah, and speaking of those partnerships, another question from Victoria is, for the Living Innovation Zones, what was the division of labor between the parties involved?
So there's different layers of parties within. There's like the city, the community, and the creative team, and then within these different buckets there may be sub-buckets. So within the city, the division of labor is the planning department and the mayor's office of civic innovation take the lead on the project. In the planning department, we do the design review, and we sort of have like the technical expertise to understand how architectural drawings work, to be able to do a critique, a design crit on a project. We sort of share the outreach of it, and they sort of, Moki sort of leads on sort of some of the PR stuff. And like, there's other departments we'll pull in, like Public Works will have to issue the permit. We go to the Arts Commission and we talk with them. And then depending, opportunistically, we might pull in the PUC if we want to tap into, the Public Utilities Commission, sorry, if we want to tap into like the electrical grid, or for a project, or the Department of Building Inspection, if we want to crawl up the side of a building, we'll need permits from them. Within, outside of the city, the creative team, we allocate a creative lead. That's oftentimes like a museum, or like and they don't have to be art sort of things. We've talked to Kaiser Permanente, it's a local healthcare provider. Kaiser is interested in doing a project focused on public health, maybe less of an art architecture sort of thing and more of like a social service kind of thing. They would then hire some other people. It might be an Arab, or it might be an IDEO, or it might be an architecture, local architecture firm, or someone sort of like that. There may be a tech partner who's involved too that can sort of do software coding, or oftentimes more than one, and they will all sort of be managed by Kaiser. And so Kaiser would be like the creative lead, and they'd be the main point of contact. And then with the community, and their role, sorry, is to design, to develop a concept and design a structure. And with the community, there's community benefit districts, are sort of nonprofits where the local property owners pay in money for neighborhood services like street sweeping and stuff like that. They have a role, and they help us with the outreach because they know who we need to talk to. We sort of try to keep the outreach pretty focused and light. We'll talk to the immediate stakeholders, property owners, neighbors, and so forth. There's also the property owners who we sort of do outreach to as well, and so that's kind of the community arm.
Cool. Hopefully that answers the question. We just have a few minutes left, and Matthew, I wanted to ask if you could explain a little bit more about how the 50-50 work, how you do 50% pro bono, 50% paid with, you know, the employees and volunteers that are involved.
Yeah, absolutely. The work itself, we're logistically split into three offices, and our staff that's on-site is about 15 people. But then each office is led by what we call a global lead. So that's myself on strategy, my partner Bora Shin on creative, and then Jake, who I mentioned earlier, on foresight. The way that we execute a project sort of from start to finish is, on the pro bono side, we'll get a application in through our website from a nonprofit who is a 501c3 organization and meets all of our criteria. We'll get back to them and generally workshop first around the scope of the project and what their needs might be in order to create a proper proposal. Once we have that proposal approved, we'll start evaluating if we have enough time on our internal resources in-house to execute certain parts of the project versus others. And if we find that there's a certain skill set or aesthetic or whatever it might be that we can't meet in-house, we'll look towards our network. There's about 350 people in that network, and they really vary drastically in skills and, interestingly, in age as well. Everywhere from 15 years old to 65 years old, we have as practitioners, and obviously that varies their intention or sort of interest in working with us, as well as to the level of which we can actually collaborate with them or what kind of role they might take on. What we've learned from volunteering or from managing volunteers over the years is really that pro bono work needs to be treated exactly like paid work, meaning we need to have agreements with everybody, a set scope, set time frame, all of that stuff to really make it a successful engagement.
Great. Thank you.
And to piggyback off of, oh, sorry.
Oh, go ahead.
And to piggyback off of Matt, we do the same where we have pro bono services agreements with all of our clients when we embark on this work. We have it has no difference in the office, where if we have a pro bono project in the office, everyone is still getting paid in the office internally. So we take on our pro bono projects based on it comes out of our profit. So we determine not only the project we might take on, develop our scope and services within tandem with the client, but then we decide what the duration is that we could actually allocate the project based on the amount of profit that we want to be able to put towards it, because everyone needs to get paid on our end. And that's part of talking about the value of the work to make sure that everyone in our firm feels that their time is of value every single day that they're in the office.
Excellent. Catherine, Matthew, Paul, and Katie, thank you guys so much for organizing us today, for sharing your really inspiring work. Really appreciate your time and appreciate all of you logging in to listen to our webinar today. This webinar will be archived for later viewing on arts.gov, so please check back. It'll be posted tomorrow, and I think you'll get an email about that, actually, if you registered for the webinar. So share it with other folks, and also register for our upcoming ones in May and June. Also, if you have questions or would like more information about NEA programs in general, or about the July Design Artworks Grant program that I manage, I'd be happy to chat further with folks. You can email at neadesign@arts.gov, and we really appreciate you listening in. Have a good day.